The Man from Snowy River by Banjo Paterson. Prelude. I have gathered these stories afar in the wind and the rain, in the land where the cattle camps are, on the edge of the plain. On the overland routes of the west, when the watches were long, I have fashioned in earnest and jest these fragments of song. They are just the rude stories one hears in sadness and mirth, the records of wandering years, and scant is their worth. Though their merits indeed are but slight, I shall not repine, if they give you one moment's delight, old comrades of mine. The Man from Snowy River. There was a movement at the station, for the word had passed around that the colt from Old Regret had got away and had joined the wild bush horses. It was worth £1,000, so all the cracks had gathered to the fray. All the tried and noted riders from the stations near and far had mustered in the homestead overnight, for the bushmen love hard riding where the wild bush horses are, and the stock horse snuffs the battle with delight. There was Harrison, who made his pile when Pardon won the cup, the old man with his hair as white as snow, but few could ride beside him when his blood was fairly up. He would go wherever horse and man could go, and Clancy, over the overflow, came down to lend a hand. No better horseman ever held reins, for never horse could throw him while the saddle girths would stand. He learnt to ride while droving on the plains. And one was there, a stripling, on a small and weedy beast. He was something like a racehorse undersized, with a touch of timmer pony, three parts thoroughbred at least, and such as are by mountain horsemen prized. He was hard and tough and wiry, just the sort that won't say die. There was courage in his quick, impatient tread, and he bore the badge of gameness in his bright and fiery eye and the proud and lofty carriage of his head. But still, so slight and weedy, one would doubt his power to stay. And the old man said,
"That horse will never do for a long and tiring gallop, lad. You'd better stop away. Those heels are far too rough for such as you."
So he waited, sad and wistful. Only Clancy stood his friend.
"I think we ought to let him come," he said. "I warrant he'll be with us when he's wanted at the end. For both his horse and he are mountain bred. He hails from Snowy River, up by Kosciuszko's side, where the hills are twice as steep and twice as rough, where a horse's hoof strikes firelight from the flint stones every stride. The man that holds his own is good enough. And the Snowy River riders on the mountains make their home where the river runs those giant hills between. I've seen full many horsemen since I first commenced to roam, but nowhere yet such horsemen have I seen."
So he went. They found the horses by the big mimosa clump. They raced away towards the mountain's brow, and the old man gave his orders.
"Boys, go at them from the jump. No use to try for fancy riding now. And Clancy, you must wheel them. Try to wheel them to the right. Ride boldly, lad, and never fear the spills, for never yet was rider that could keep this mob in sight. For never yet was rider that could keep the mob in sight, if once they gain the shelter of those hills."
So Clancy rode to wheel them. He was racing on the wing where the best and boldest riders took their place, and he raced his stock horse past them, and he made the ranges ring with the stock whip, and he met them face to face. Then they halted for a moment, when he swung the dreaded lash, but they saw their well-loved mountain full in view, and they charged beneath the stock whip with a sharp and sudden dash, and off into the mountain scrub they flew. Then fast the horsemen followed, where the gorges deep and black resounded to the thunder of their tread.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.